Today's episode of This Week in Startups is brought to you by Citrix GoToMeeting. Meeting is believing. Visit GoToMeeting.com and use the promo code TWIST to begin your free 30-day trial. And by Audible.com, a leading provider of spoken audio information and entertainment. Listen to audiobooks whenever and wherever you want. Visit Audible.com/TWIST for your free audiobook. And by AWS Activate, the Amazon Web Services Startup Program. It's easy to start and scale your business with AWS. Visit aws.amazon.com/activate.
Hey, everybody. On today's This Week in Startup, we have two companies working with law enforcement. Incredible technologies from Yardarm Technology and ShotSpotter. Yardarm, the first one, is putting chips into Glocks and rifles that let you know that a gun has been removed from its holster, or that it's been fired, or that it's been taken from the police officer who has it. This is really amazing, amazing technology that's going to allow us to have safer streets. In addition, ShotSpotter allows you, through triangulation of sound, to know when a gunshot went off, and within maybe 5 or 10 or 15 feet where that gun went off. It's in dozens and dozens of communities, and it is changing everything in law enforcement. These two companies could drastically reduce the amount of people killed in the line of duty or other things that happen in the line of duty. It's an amazing episode. Stick with us. You're going to love it.
It's what it's all about, man. They said money is the root of all evil. How it feeds my people. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you. Yeah. Money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to This Week in Startups. It's me, Jason Calacanis, your host. We've been doing this show for 5 wonderful years. Yes, almost 500 episodes. And what do we do on the show? Well, we try to feature amazing entrepreneurs, technology, innovation, sometimes the investors or pundits who are around that technology and innovation. And one of the things that's been very top of mind of late is policing. Because we've had a lot of horrible instances of malfeasance, perhaps, or just errors in judgment, or perhaps, you know, just the difficult things that happen when policing occurs. I have a lot of cops in my family. My brother was a cop in Flatbush. He's a fireman now. My grandfather was a fireman. My uncle's a sergeant. My cousin's a sergeant. One of my best friends growing up is a lieutenant. I got cops all over my family. So I understand where they're coming from. And I could also, just like the rest of us as Americans, can understand what's happening on the other side of the fence, what's happening on the other side of the table where people are being killed. And you know what? A lot of this policing, it seems like, is becoming a little militarized, perhaps, and you have some bad apples, like you do in any line of work, and it could be better. And as a technologist who's been in the technology industry my entire life, I know that technology can have a positive impact. Now, a lot of people say, hey, that's conceited. You people in the technology business think too much of yourselves. You think that you can solve everything. Well, you know what? Until anybody starts solving as many goddamn problems as the technology industry is, I am going to continue to believe that technology can be the transforming force in our lifetime to make things better for humanity, society, individuals. And why should policing be any different? If transportation, if education, if business productivity, if farming, if, you know, everything is being transformed, commerce, e-commerce, advertising, every industry is being transformed by technology, why would policing not? What would make policing immune to the amazing advances in technology? Now, it may happen last. It may happen, you know, middle of the pack. They may be laggards. They might be in the middle of the pack. You know, they may not be like, you know, data scientists or even teachers might get the technology first. Who knows? But let's face it, cops are gearheads. They love technology when it comes to firearms, when it comes to cars. They're not tech savvy. They are tech savvy. They like gear. And so the gear is changing, and the gear could change everything. That's my belief. And so I've started looking Because, you know, I'm an investor and I'm a curious person and I have a show to do here. And I got the launch festival in March where I try to put spectacular technologies on stage for the 8th year in a row, 10,000 people. You can come as my guest for free. Just type launch festival 2015 into your browser. Come to the launch festival as my guest. That's right. You can come to my conference for free and see the best speakers that other conferences charge $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 to come. I do it for free. You come to my event as a guest of Jason, as an FOJ, friend of Jason. That's how I do it. Anyway, today on the program, Jeff Schaff, am I pronouncing it correct?
Jim.
I'm sorry, Jim. Schaff, am I pronouncing your last?
Schaff.
Jim Schaff. All right, I got everything wrong so far.
That's okay. Except
I give this great speech in the beginning, Jim.
So that's how you start.
And then I screw up your pronunciation of name. Look at what an amazing
broadcaster.
That's
the only thing that goes wrong as we go through product demos and start talking about tech. That's
exactly
great.
Now, Jim, you are the VP of marketing at Yardarm Technologies, which is a very cool company, which I'm not sure you guys reached out to me. I think at some point I was tweeting about stuff. Yeah, I got an opinion on everything, as anybody who's watched this show for more than 90 seconds can attest to. And I saw what you were doing. And I said, my God, what a no-brainer. Tell my audience, the This Week in Startups audience, what Yardarm Technology does and why we should care.
So you're right on point with technology in law enforcement. It's a big movement for them, from personal cameras to in-car cameras. And Yardarm is taking that technology and putting it into the firearm, probably one of the most important pieces of gear an officer carries.
Is the gun the most important? Maybe the radio? I guess.
They're hand in hand for sure.
Yeah, exactly. You guys are doing something with the gun.
We are. We're putting electronics in the gun. We're taking electronics, making them small, putting it in the firearm, and connecting that firearm to command.
All right. So listen, a demo is worth 1,000 minutes of program. So here we go. I'm going to just pull this up here, and you're going to get ready to demo. All right, here on my great, beautiful camera. Hey, thanks, producer Jacob, and Emmy Award-winning producer Jackie for setting my little camera up here. So what am I looking at here, this piece of technology?
So in your right hand, you have a larger unit that would fit inside of a long gun, like an AR-15, a carbine.
Mm-hmm. A rifle.
A rifle, the shotgun.
Got it.
The one on the left hand is much smaller, and that's what would fit inside the handgun.
A Glock, a 9mm.
That fits inside of a Glock.
Got
9mm,
all right. That's
40 cal.
That's what my brother had. He had a Glock. I got a Ruger. I'm a pistol kind of guy myself, but my brother Josh had a Glock. Okay, so here it is. Let me see this here.
Sure.
Now, this is not an actual gun.
That is an airsoft.
It's in a holster. It's in the holster. And there's nothing different looking than this, but I know that right here, worked with you guys, this is where you're putting your piece of technology. You're sliding that right in there.
You want to?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. Take it out. Well, actually, why don't we do the demo here? This is easier.
Do the demo?
So let's see what it does. You're putting in some sensors and a little computer here. What does it actually do?
So it is providing a real-time telemetry feed to our servers. Our servers are up in the cloud.
Got it.
And this is the firearm's giving us a live feed.
So a live feed. Video feed?
No, it's giving us location.
Location.
And sensor data.
Okay, so here we go. I've got a map up here.
So.
And this is a map of the WeWork offices where I tape my program from. Go to WeWork.com, get a desk for like $600. It's an amazing place to work. You can work on the same floor as me if you get on 7. Boom, that's a little plug. And that's Church Street and Golden Gate right off of Market, a couple of blocks from Zendesk and Twitter. And we see a gun in gray. What does gray mean?
That means it's in the holster.
All right, let's do a demo here. Go ahead. Show me how it works. You got the gun and you're pulling it out of the holster.
You pull it out of the holster.
Okay.
Immediately changes the status of the icon.
Okay, so now an orange.
Yeah, now it's an orange or an amber alert. So
amber
now
alert,
if you were in a dispatch center or a police chief or someone in command, you could know if someone in one of your officers in the field had unholstered their weapon.
Or anybody. Any other officer should know technically,
absolutely,
right? Like if we're all working in the same shift.
Somebody in a car 3 blocks over could see that one of the officers just 3 blocks down the road in the Tenderloin just drew his gun.
Yeah. Now, this could be for multiple reasons.
Absolutely.
The gun could need to be adjusted.
Oh, yeah. The officer
in the holster.
There's many reasons the officer may unholster their weapon during the day. But if you know that an officer 4 blocks away is doing a traffic stop.
Yeah.
And suddenly their gun's unholstered.
This saves a critical 30 seconds or 15 seconds or 10 seconds or even a minute of why was that gun drawn?
Sure.
So like if the officer was actually in an engagement right now where they had to draw their weapon for a reason, they may not have the time on their radio to say, I have 2 armed suspects and I've just drawn my weapon.
Especially if
they mean that they may not want to take their hand off their gun right there.
Yeah, as soon as you draw your weapon, your radio's tends to, if you're right-handed, your radio's on your left shoulder.
Yep.
And if you draw your gun and you're right-handed, your gun's now in your right hand.
Yep.
Often you have both hands on your weapon.
It's an issue.
That's how you hold your weapon.
Right. So this that alone, just so people know, like that alone, I think, makes this technology revolutionary just because just knowing the weapon's been unholstered is such an important event. As my uncle told me very early on when my brother was going to be one of the questions cops get when you meet somebody who's a cop, the first question they ask is like, have you ever taken your gun out? Have you fired your weapon? And the first thing anybody who's a seasoned officer will say is, I hope to retire with never taking my weapon out and never firing it, right? All right, so now what happens when a gun, if tragically or in an emergency situation has to be used, what happens?
So officer in the field has to fire his weapon.
Yep.
I'm going to
Yeah, that's an airsoft. Yeah, boom.
So you get a discharge.
And now you get an alert there, boom. And if multiple happens, you would get multiple.
And of course, at this point, if the officer gets into foot pursuit, you can actually continue to track them in a live foot pursuit scenario.
Right.
So you'll actually be able to see that, officer may immediately holster their weapon and enter foot pursuit.
All right. When I get back, I want to ask you the absolute critical question, which is, what do police officers and police unions think of this technology, and will they try to stop it because maybe this data can be used against them when we get back on This Week in Startups? Hey, everybody. Let me take a moment to thank my friends at Citrix for creating such an amazing product like GoToMeeting. I have the ad copy right here. I could read it, but I don't need to. And that's because I use it every day, literally every day. I do 2 or 3 meetings with startups, partners, employees, designers on GoToMeeting. Why do I do that? Because it's so easy for me to switch control of the screen from person to person, to do chat, to record the call if I need to. And it always starts on time, and there's always great audio and video fidelity. Most people today do not have landlines. Therefore, conference calls have been totally destroyed. And then some people insist on using free products where the quality is terrible. The solution to this quality problem, and the fact that people think, a lot of millennials in fact, think you can use a mobile phone to actually do a phone call with an investor is crazy. Get over voice over IP. Use something like GoToMeeting where it's high fidelity because you're on a broadband connection and the HD is gorgeous. And you can switch who's presenting versus who's controlling, all these incredible combinations of things. And you can keep the HD video up while you're sharing your screen and have no problems. And by the way, if there are problems with your connection, it knows, it's so smart, it drops the video and says, hey, we're going to take your video down, but make the audio better, because the audio is the key, obviously, right? And you get these beautiful, elegant warnings like, hey, your video quality is dropping because your broadband connection is bad. We're going to switch you to audio. Like, that's very elegant when you see people who have developed a product that far along. And it's because GoToMeeting's been doing just this for so long. Go to GoToMeeting.com and hit the try a free button. Use the promo code TWIST. Use the promo code TWIST. Thank you so much to my friends at GoToMeeting. I rely on your product day in and day out, and for that I thank you, and for supporting my podcast, which I've been doing for now 5 years. Thank you so much for giving me your support. I do appreciate it. A+ on that product. Go ahead and go try it. GoToMeeting.com, use the promo code TWIST. Okay, let's get back to this amazing episode. Hey, everybody, welcome back to This Week in Startups. Jim is with me. He's the VP of Marketing at Yardarm Technologies, which is making an intelligent sensor for guns that allows people in the police department to know when an officer has drawn his or her gun, fired the gun, when we left our demo, which was quite impressive, we saw that, hey, the gun's been drawn, it's been fired, where on the map that's occurred. The first question I have, and I got a ton of questions about this technology, sure, but the first one I have is, will the police unions allow the gun to be tracked because cops might think this data would be used against them?
So we've already actually had a conversation with the head of the California Police Union.
Okay.
Or the law firm that manages the police unions for 911 departments in California.
Right. Which gives you an indication, the fact that there is, you know, like a union and a law, a lot of lawyers involved, that this is serious business.
Unions are very powerful in law enforcement.
Yes, of course.
They have a lot of say on what cannot be used in the department, and it's negotiated. Almost pretty much everything is negotiated.
Absolutely. And with good reason, because cops are putting their lives at risk every day.
Every day. So our conversation couldn't have gone better. And I think it's because you weigh the positives of the officer safety aspect, the ability for an officer to receive support and receive assistance from other officers quickly in scenarios where it's probably life-threatening.
Mm-hmm.
That carries a strong weight. The head of the law firm was like, I don't have a problem with it. It needs to be negotiated.
Yeah.
We don't want this to become an oversight tool. We want it to become an officer safety tool.
Okay. So what's the difference? What is an oversight tool versus a safety tool? And how do you thread that needle?
So an oversight tool is something that is constantly sending breadcrumbs back to command. They can see where they go. They see everything they do. The way we've built the system is to be fully customizable and configurable by department, by group within the department, by officer. So rather than always showing where the officer is at all the times, we actually put the sensor to sleep if it's holstered. So we're not actually showing a constant breadcrumb over the officers. As soon as an officer unholsters their weapon, we come awake, and even then, we may not send any data on to command. They may say, our officers, I mean, we've talked to a police chief from Detroit, and his first comment was, my officers draw their guns every day, all day. I don't need to know when they unholster. I just want to know when they fire their weapon.
So each department is run in a certain way independently, different municipalities. They're going to look at Yardarm's technology and say, hey, checkbox here. Firing is what we want everybody to know about. Unholstering, maybe your immediate supervisor or your partner could know.
Yep.
Maybe your partner could know, but that's it.
So we're able to set rules and create the database in a way that allows us to do that. So you can do it by department. So your detectives may want to know if there's an unholstering event in the field for them, because they don't unholster as often as the rank and file officers, the patrol officers. They may unholster 4, 5, 6 times a day. The detectives, if they're unholstering something maybe more important happening, or a plainclothes officer, or a bailiff at a court, if they unholster, that's a much bigger deal than if someone who's doing a patrol might. Because an officer approaching a car that they say, I don't know who's in this car. It looks like 4 guys wearing gang colors. They're going to approach the car with their hand on their gun, and they might even have their gun out.
Yeah. So the truth is, though, you guys are coming after dash cams in general.
Yes.
And computers in cop cars.
Mm-hmm.
And you're coming after smartphones, probably. Every cop's got a smartphone these days. So it's not like this is 2000 or 99 or 1995. Cops currently, majority of them, their location of their squad car is known at all times, correct?
Predominantly. Not all departments, but predominantly.
Right. So maybe some local yokels don't have that because they don't have the budget and they got a 10-person squad. But any major city, they know where every cop car is, just like they know where every ambulance is and every fire.
Absolutely.
I mean, if UPS can know where the UPS driver is, for the love of God, we got to know where the cops are.
And dash cams are becoming pretty much ubiquitous. They're across the board. And dash cams really are breaking trail for us. Because, one, initially officers were against it, unions were against it. They thought it was going to be used for oversight. And they quickly realized that it helped avoid or offset litigation and liability very quickly.
Yes.
We were talking to the ex-sheriff of Sacramento County, and he said that when they installed dash cams, they avoided a $5 million litigation 3 months into the program.
Of course. I mean, how many bad guys if you're a bad guy or gal, it's possible, and you're willing to do whatever heinous crime, you're absolutely going to be willing to say the cop beat you up and lie. I mean, lying is way down the list from robbing or raping or murdering. So they, of course, they're going to say the cops beat me up. Now, of course, the cops do beat people up once in a while, sadly. And so you have to account for that as well. But the number of complaints when cameras came out of police abuse went down dramatically.
Absolutely.
And there was a very interesting thing about the wearable cameras I read, where the cops started to figure out, and as we always say on the program, the street finds its own use for technology, William Gibson. Cops started having not only were there less instances, false instances of people saying, you know, cops abused me, and not only did cop abuse go down, coincidentally, but also the number of times people resisted arrest went down.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know why? It's a totally non-obvious reason. Take a guess of why resisting arrest went down.
Because it's embarrassing.
It's embarrassing for people to know they're on camera. Exactly. Yeah. But people didn't know the cops were wearing the camera because these little cameras were so small. They just looked like a Pez dispenser. Nobody really knew. What the cops started doing without being told was they started pointing to their camera and saying, "Hey, dummy, you're on camera. This is all being recorded and you will be charged with resisting arrest. And I'll have it on video. So just let me cuff you, dumbass. And everybody can just go on with their day. You're being recorded." So by telling people they're being recorded, the behavior went up on both sides. The complaints went down. The lawsuits go down. Now, is this going to make cops resistant to taking their guns out when they might need to because they're afraid that taking the gun out is going to lead to an investigation, do you think?
That's one of those.
Has
really
that come
depends
up?
Who you're talking with.
Yeah.
So if you talk to people who are very strong union member, you know, rank and file officers who are, you know, strong union people.
Yep.
It comes up.
Yeah.
But as soon as you start moving into sergeants, lieutenants, commanders, they don't care how often their officers draw their weapons.
Right.
Because they don't, and they don't want, and they want to be careful that they're not, there's no concern that they're afraid to draw their weapons. And so
it's a clear protocol of when to draw your weapon.
Yeah. So
like if you feel that the person could be armed and you're under threat or the public safety is at risk, you draw your weapon.
And it's interesting because there's definitely protocols. There are protocols for when you draw your weapon, and the commanders and the sergeants and lieutenants would like the officers to absolutely follow those regulations and guidelines. And this is just like in dash cameras, certain procedures that might have been skipped before are no longer being skipped because they know it's being recorded.
Yeah.
Officers don't care because predominantly officers are doing their job correctly.
Right. See, this is the problem that people
don't. The 99% that are doing their job correctly are benefited.
I mean, it's like teachers. You know, people hear about a terrible teacher doing something horrific because it's on the cover of the New York Post. Oh, my God, this teacher had an affair with their 15-year-old student. You don't hear about the 999,000, you know.
Who spent 3 extra hours a day to help their kids.
Exactly. So they get, you know, one bad cop, you know, all of a sudden 50,000 cops are going to be painted with that same brush to a certain extent. So you don't know, though, because this, correct me if I'm wrong, does not have a cellular connection in it. It's not going over the, you know, CDMA network or whatever, LTE network. This is connecting to a smartphone or to a base station in the car via Bluetooth.
Or the radio.
Or the radio.
Yep.
Via Bluetooth or whatever the radio technology. What's that called? What's radio technology? Like how to connect to that?
It's
proprietary center or something?
RF.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So this is So if my gun gets taken from me like Stray Dog, the Kurosawa film, of course you're familiar with. I'm just dropping film references up in a while and showing off of my Kurosawa knowledge. So in Stray Dog, the guy gets his gun stolen. If somebody steals the gun, we know the gun's departed the range
so we
of
actually
the officer.
We have a separation event. We actually can send
but
a separation
But you can't track
event.
It.
We can actually beacon find it if an officer gets within 50 feet of it.
That's
meters.
Nice, but I think the holy grail would be if we could track the gun for some period of time because bad guy doesn't know this is in there or how to get it out.
Thank God for the current course of the wearables market.
Okay, so what do you mean by that?
So the wearables,
why does it have it in it?
So
is there some issue with battery
power? Size and power.
Okay,
right?
So it's a battery issue.
So GSM radios are bigger than that.
Got it.
And there are some newer GSM radios that are getting smaller and smaller.
Got it.
And the wearables market with the smartwatches and the smart tech is forcing the chip manufacturers to start working on miniaturization and power. Because what had happened is all the phones were getting bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And so rather than reduce the size of the chips, even though they could, instead they added more stuff.
Yeah.
Right? So they didn't reduce the footprint. They just kept piling on.
Yeah, they're like, oh, everybody wants a Note. Everybody wants the iPhone 6. Let's put more batteries in, and let's put more features in, and don't worry about size.
And one of the chip manufacturers told us, the manufacturers even said, don't change the footprint because that way my design doesn't have to change as much.
Yeah.
Right? And so they literally had...
All right, so that's the issue. But on a big rifle...
Absolutely.
On a shotgun, you know, you already have a bigger thing here I see a big battery in it, so that's going to last a long time.
That actually is a GSM-enabled.
Oh, it is? Okay, so I just jumped the fence.
You
do have this on the roadmap.
Absolutely.
Okay, so if a serious weapon, like a shotgun, or I mean, all weapons are serious, but a shotgun and an AR rifle are particularly serious, if that gets taken, you could actually pull out your smartphone as a cop and see the person running away with the gun.
Absolutely.
Oh, my goodness.
And it's interesting.
That is awesome.
There's another interesting little side on that is police chiefs have become very interested in the rifle version because now every squad car now is equipped with a rifle. It's standard practice. They're still not issuing by officer, but they're absolutely issuing by car.
Of course.
Which means all the bad guys know there is now a rifle in the back of the car or inside the car.
Right.
And theft is becoming an issue.
Really?
Yes.
Has it really become an issue?
It has
People
become
have
an issue.
The gall to steal a rifle from a police car.
Or steal the entire police car just to get what's inside of it.
Yeah.
And the other problem is SWAT teams, because SWAT teams are typically rank and file officers who are also on the SWAT team. They carry go bags.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bag with all their gear. It's got bulletproof vest. It's got their flak vest, their helmet, their Kevlar helmet.
Yeah,
all
good stuff.
And their gun.
Yeah.
And they put them into this really cool bag, and they put it in their trunk. Sure. And if you can
identify, should just be, I mean, you'll just be giving them all kinds of sensors for every device
you
they
bet.
Have.
And you bet.
Boom.
So we're entering field trials with the handguns, but we've actually done fully configured testing with AR-15s
in
the range.
Hey, so let me ask you a question here. You know, you could put a gyroscope in this, and you would actually know at what angle I was holding the weapon, right? So, and you could probably rebuild the weapon in 3D space, maybe not perfectly, but you could get an idea of if this weapon was pointed down. Certainly you could have down and up and sideways.
Yep.
I don't know if you could actually know where in the room it was pointing, but you could start to get there. And is that on the roadmap? And what would the impact of that be?
So,
because now you know it's drawn, but I mean, knowing it's drawn and it's at the side pointing down is one thing, but knowing it's drawn and aimed, that's like the next trigger event. Like, this is incredible for your partner to know that your weapon is pulled, but to know that it's pointed at somebody, that's a big deal.
So for us, direction of aim, direction of fire is one of the features that is on the roadmap, and we have R&D working on it right now.
Yeah.
It does not have a gyroscope in the current hardware version.
Right. Again, back to size.
Our commercialized version, we actually have already identified the gyroscope we're going to add. So,
oh, good.
So our commercialized first 1.0 product will have a gyroscope.
Mm.
We actually can do it with accelerometers and magnetometers, but our level of accuracy is not where we would want to commercialize it.
Right.
So we're adding the gyroscope.
You know, the thing is also, if you're going to add this, it's got to be accurate because,
exactly.
Oh my God, you're going to have like this expert testimony of there was a tragedy. Ferguson comes to mind.
Yep.
And, you know, if that data is not accurate and not reliable, which no data is 100%, holy cow. I mean, somebody could go to jail, you know, for murder or not, you know, like it could be a very serious thing.
Well, and the good news
is, big responsibility. It wouldn't be
there's a way to mitigate that as well, right? So one, we want to make sure that when we do deploy that as a feature, we're comfortable with it and we can stand behind it. And the other is, you can actually apply a quality to the reading you're getting, right?
Of course, yeah.
So you can say, this is we have a strong confidence in the data that we're giving you, or you know, the officer got out of his car and ran up next to the power converter for that block, which was this huge electromagnet, and every sensor in the gun was set.
Yeah.
It's pointing up that way, right?
Yeah.
And so we can actually tell if there's a strong influence on the weapon that might be affecting the reading. And if it's not, we can then say high confidence, or if it's some really wacky outside influence, we can say it's a low confidence reading.
What about the military? Do they have this already? I got to think the military, I mean, because they have, they're wearing goggles that are sending that signal. When they went to get, you know, Osama bin Laden, they were watching, I believe, if the movies are correct, the actual view of the SEAL team.
Well, so different scenarios are going to have different
levels of technology.
If you have a satellite, geosynchronously set over the place where you're having your thing, you're going to probably have real-time communication.
Hillary can see what's going down.
Exactly. So,
but with this, you do have to think like, oh, my God, you know, if you put a sight on there, I mean, these Glocks are made to put sights and laser pointers and all kinds of stuff on there. Why wouldn't they have like a GoPro-like camera that would sync to what you're doing? And boy, does that equal like an entire sweet spot. Not only can your partner see that you pulled the gun, or your commander, your desk sergeant, they could see actually what the gun sees.
Yeah. So,
oh my God, that's incredible.
Interesting enough, we've had,
does that exist?
It doesn't. It does at some level, but it doesn't.
What
really.
Level? The military?
At the military level, there are certain new technologies that are coming that replicate it, but we haven't seen anything that's all that intriguing. Hmm. And right now, they do not have deployed in weapon technology that does what we do.
In weapon technology, right. It's all right. Add-ons.
And they don't have even by soldier technology that they're using right now for, like, they're not geolocating soldiers.
They're not geolocating soldiers.
No.
That's impossible. No, come on. Really?
No.
Oh, my God.
Now, granted, there may be units like, you know, the Rangers the Force Recon, SEALs.
Yeah.
They're probably generating that.
Definitely.
But like individual soldiers each don't carry a radio. There's one radio person per platoon.
And then there's the radio.
The military is even more expensive.
All right. So, but you're going after primarily the cops.
So we're doing law enforcement first, primarily because if you deploy military first, they'll block you from bringing it to law enforcement.
Oh, really? That's fascinating.
Yes, they will. So, so do law enforcement and then move into military.
All right.
So
final question: When is this going to be deployed? You going to do any trials? What's the status of the company?
Field trials start this month.
Wow. So we got you right before that. What do you expect to come out of the field trials?
We're going to get a lot of understanding of how that acts, not in a controlled setting like a range, but when an officer's running around in the field.
Oh, it's a good break. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. It's a big difference in the quality of sensor data.
Yeah.
That's our first goal is that, just to make sure that we can understand what that looks like and adjust for it.
Yep.
And then the second phase is really how do we integrate into command infrastructure?
Mm.
How do we work with dispatch? How do we train dispatch?
Yeah, because these are all systems by Motorola and all those other people who do
those
systems.
And that's how
you're not rebuilding those systems. You're going to just plug into them.
Yeah, and that's how we are going to market. We're partnering with the land mobile radio operators, with the dispatch centers.
Yep.
We're selling through them. We're working through them as a value-added offering.
All right, listen, thank you so much for coming on the program, Jim. Continued success with Yardarm Technologies. I think this is long overdue. I think it's going to really help protect cops and the public, of course. And I really thank you for making it. I mean, it's the start of something good, I think.
Yeah, I mean, for us, it's if we can save an officer's life.
Oh, my God.
We are a successful company no matter what happens.
It's well said, well said. All right, stick with us. We'll be back. Yes, Audible. I love Audible. It's so great to read and ad read for Audible because I don't need to read any of the copy. They have 150,000 titles in almost every, or in all genres, actually. And I have dozens of books in my collection. I was about to say over 100. It's probably getting to 100. And you can get a free book right now, audible.com/twist. And the book I'm going to tell you to get at audible.com/twist, which is a free 30-day trial, is Moonwalking with Einstein. It's a book about memory. It's a book about the Memory Olympics and a New York Times writer who gets in there and learns how to become a world-class memory athlete. It is fascinating and awesome. But I'm also listening to Creativity right now, which is a story of Pixar, and the Steve Jobs autobiography by Walter Isaacson is amazing. There's so many great books on Audible. I've listened to so many. Bird by Bird is a book on writing I've listened to recently that's amazing. Born Standing Up is Steve Martin's audiobook I love. Nothing But the Shouting, or All Over But the Shouting, is a memoir by a New York Times journalist that is amazing and read by him all over, but the shouting has nothing to do with technology, but it's great. And Good to Great is amazing. And The Five Dysfunctions of a Team is amazing. I could go on and on and on. Not to mention Sheryl Sandberg's book, Lean In, and other books that you know, like Catching Twitter, all amazing, all available on Audible. And you can just go to audible.com/twist and get that free book. Moonwalking with Einstein is my pick for this week. And if you do, forward your registration from Audible to audible@launch.co, forward it to audible@launch.co, and you will be entered to win an iPad mini signed by me. Yes, that's right, audible@launch.co. Forward that sign-up form to audible@launch.co, and you will win an iPad mini signed by me, or you'll be in a contest. Can't guarantee you win, of course. And now go ahead and thank @audible_com. And I'm just so proud to have them as a partner. Really, thank you, Audible. You guys have been so great to me over the years, gals over there, for supporting me, Donald Katz and everybody. It's a really great company. And I'm a huge fan. And I use it every day. So what more do you need to know? You need to use it every day, too. Get smarter. Okay, let's get back to this program. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to This Week in Startups, the show where we look at technology, startups, and new products that are going to change the world. And the product we have today is just amazing. This technology could change everything in law enforcement, and it actually is. It's called ShotSpotter, and I will let James Beldock, who is the Senior Vice President of Products and Engineering, and formerly the CEO of the company, explain to us what it does. And I think I can do that best by pulling up sound. And I'm going to play four sound clips, and then you tell us what these four sound clips actually represent. I'll play the first and the fourth. Hold on a second. Here we go. Here we go. Okay. Here's the second. Here's the third. And the final one. Obviously, four different clips of sound from gunfire, maybe five or six shots were fired. But what are what's the difference between four different sound clips?
So what you just heard was a single shooting.
Shooting, not four different ones.
It's exactly the same shooting heard by four different ShotSpotter sensors deployed in a city here on the West Coast. That shooting took place within the last 72 hours at about 9 p.m. at night.
Okay. So a shooting occurred, and you picked up on four microphones the sound of the shooting, and gunshots are unmistakable, are they not?
Gunshots and explosions sound like nothing else. The sound radiates out a really long distance, something between a mile and a mile and a half away.
Yes, that's why when you're in Los Angeles and somebody's firing in Compton or Inglewood or Venice, where these things go off, you hear something very light. But when you're in Venice, you hear something tremendously different. I mean, anybody who lives in Venice, in Los Angeles, hears gunshots every week.
Everybody in Los Angeles hears them even more often than that. They just don't know it.
Ah.
By the time you're a mile away from a gunshot sounds a lot like you tapping your fingers on the table. If you're just listening for sounds that sound like tapping, and you've got a network of sensors that can all collaborate and corroborate that a single source created that, you can listen to very quiet noises that otherwise people would ignore.
All right. And so this is done, obviously, through physical devices in communities that have been set up by law enforcement and ShotSpotter.
That's right. We have about 5,000 ShotSpotter sensors deployed in 85 U.S. cities and in five countries around the world. The sensors, almost all of them, we own and operate on behalf of the city.
Oh, I see. So you own and operate them and you license the data.
Yes.
And the software to them.
This is gunfire data, much as AccuWeather licenses weather data.
All right, so here we go. I'm pulling up your HUD, or your incident portal, as it says here, ShotSpotter incident portal. And for those who can't see it, on the bottom right here, taking up about half the screen, is a map with a circle and a radius and a center. But on the left, I see audio available from seven sensors. And it has like the standard audio signature you would see on SoundCloud or other places. It says seven rounds at 794 Green Street and a beat of three. Don't know what that means. And when it was published, what exactly am I looking at here? I just described it for the audience.
So this is an incident that took place in East Palo Alto, California.
In Palo Alto, here.
East Palo Alto.
East Palo Alto.
Which about a decade ago was the murder capital of the country.
What?
Wait, wait. On a per capita basis.
East Palo Alto here is murder capital.
It was about a decade ago.
Really?
Yeah. And they've had
That's fascinating. I thought Bed-Stuy was the murder capital. Will we murder for capital? Sorry, I don't mean to quote.
There are a huge number of changes that East Palo Alto has been able to implement in the last decade.
Got it.
Certainly gentrification hasn't hurt.
Yeah.
But it is actually the case that they've had a 43% reduction in homicides. A lot of that is a result of the fact that they actually know about gun crime when it occurs now. They didn't used to. The statistics.
So you're claiming that you, ShotSpotter, had a dramatic impact in lowering the homicide rate because you're taking guns off the street or criminals know that they're going to get caught?
There are two effects. The primary effect is that police show up on the scene every time as opposed to 1 out of 10 times. So here are the statistics. On average on the West Coast, somebody calls 911 when there is gunfire 13% of the time.
Whoa. Shots fired. 911 only gets called 13% of the time. Why is that? Is that a diffusion of responsibility?
In a nice neighborhood, if you hear gunfire once a year, the first thing you will do is find your phone, call 911 and tell them that a gunshot occurred.
So in Pack Heights, it's going to happen 100% of the time, or Brentwood or Bel Air.
You'll probably get over-reporting. So maybe 300% of the time that a gun is fired, do you actually get a phone call? Three people call each time.
The Christmas tree, all the lights are going off at dispatch.
That's exactly right. By contrast, if you hear gunfire every 2 hours, every night of the week, nobody calls 911.
Right, because they're like, well, it's the OK Corral here. Somebody must be calling it. It's de rigueur.
There are two problems. One is that people are used to it. So if it's happening every night, they don't want to be on the phone with the police every night. In fact, they don't want to get involved. They want to live their lives. And
right.
They have a right to live their lives.
And there's also a no snitch mentality in some communities.
That's the second piece, which is that people begin to develop the idea that if they pick up the phone, they're actually involving themselves and snitching to the police.
Which, in certain communities, if you snitch, you get shot yourself, or there'll be ramifications. And two, let's face it, calling the police, if you're a black man in society, you don't want to have any interactions based on what we've seen of late. It's very dangerous to engage the police in certain communities. You can't say that. I can. I understand. You work with law enforcement.
I don't know if you noticed that the recording of the Ferguson shooting, or the purported recording of the Ferguson shooting, was actually released by the tech company whose product was used to record it by mistake during a video chat, and actually recorded the 10 shots. We took a look at those 10 shots and were able to verify that there really was a gun being fired, and that the source of the gun fire wasn't moving. It moved not at all between those 10 rounds.
Oh, so let's dig into that for a minute here.
You bet.
Somebody had a recording of the Ferguson shooting. It was another company doing technology. Like what? Like the
ShotSpotter is not deployed in Ferguson. The closest ShotSpotter system is in St. Louis.
Ah.
However, there was a citizen doing video chat on a dating service or some kind of video messaging site.
Oh, interesting.
During the shooting, that person ended up it took a little while. That person ended up getting that to his or her lawyer, and his lawyer released it to her lawyer. His lawyer released it to CNN on the 26th of August. It's about 3 weeks after the shooting.
I wasn't aware of that. And so you were able to use your technology to know the cop was not moving around. It was a steady single spot.
That's right. There were 10 rounds fired. The first 6 rounds were fired within about 4 seconds. There was a 3-second pause, and then the last 4 rounds were fired. Now, anybody could have told you that by listening to it.
Sure. But knowing that they didn't move because of triangulation or something, or
That's where we come in, except—
yeah. You had no triangulation.
We couldn't triangulate anything.
Right.
We had somebody else's smartphone that happened to be in one spot. What we could do is use some patented technology we have to use the bounces of the sound off the buildings. And since the buildings didn't move during the shooting—
got it.
And we can tell you that the exact echo pattern occurred on every one of the shots. We know that the person shooting the gun didn't move more than 3 feet during the whole experience.
Wow. And so that is completely relevant because it's not like they were charging the victim or running away from the victim.
That's right. We don't know if the victim was moving, although the eyewitness reports are that he or she wasn't. He wasn't.
He wasn't.
What we also know, and this is interesting, is that we could authenticate whether this is real or not. So there's still some question as to whether this audio is really of the shooting or somebody else firing 10 rounds. If we were to find out the location that it was taken at, which we don't know yet, we could tell you whether it's consistent with
because of the
that actual physical location.
Right. So may I ask, when was the first deployment of this technology in the United States or in the world. Yeah.
In 1996, Redwood City had what they called a celebratory gunfire problem. This means that on three different days during the year, on New Year's Eve, on July 4th, and Cinco de Mayo out here on the West Coast, people would go outside in
Redwood
City and yeehaw and shoot their guns in the air. Now, the problem is that the bullet goes up, comes back down.
Yeah.
And for a while, I used to travel with a bullet that had landed about 2 feet from the three-year-old daughter of the city council member in Redwood City who first pushed through.
It's dangerous to do this because the bullet's going thousands of feet in the air and then it's picking up velocity on the way back down.
That's right. Your average bullet is moving several thousand feet and it's moving at somewhere between Mach 1 and Mach 2. When it comes back down, it's reached terminal velocity and it's still capable of killing people.
Wow. Dangerous. So you guys installed something all the way back then, or?
The founders of ShotSpotter.
ShotSpotter, yeah.
Built a system really into the city. That they learned how to build this in the city because the math is fairly easy. We've been locating other events on the planet using the exact same math for decades. Earthquakes are found using precisely the same math. It's just that pressure waves move more quickly through the earth than sound moves through the air.
Explain to me the basic science here. The sound wave has a certain strength. There's air pressure. What exactly, and without going into your patents and all that kind of stuff, what is the basic technology you're referring to here?
We have 32 patents. It would take a while to go through them. Yeah. Here's the summary.
Yeah.
When a gun is fired, the sound of that gun travels out at the speed of sound, by definition. If there are sensors placed throughout the city, they will be at slightly different distances from the gun, depending on where the buildings on which they're placed are located.
Sure.
On average, a sensor will hear the shooting at 200 meters, and then another one at 800 meters, and another one at 1600 meters. And so each of those will hear the sound at slightly different times.
And will they hear the sound differently?
They will. In fact, you and your listeners just heard the sound differently.
So the computer can tell, hey, and I'm just raising my hands up and down here, the volume
amplitude
the amplitude of the sound wave or the sound is one very important variable, and then when it hit each sensor is the other variable. You know, when you say 100 meters or 1,000 meters, what's the number of seconds or fractions of a second difference?
Sound moves at 1,100 feet per second or 340 some odd meters per second at sea level at normal temperature. We have to know all of those variables to do this.
Oh, right. You need to know the sea level and the temperature to know.
Precisely. But it is the case that, so if a sensor is 1,000 feet away, it will be 1 second or a little bit less than 1 second later that sensor hears the sound. And when we have 10 shots, the first shot and the last shot may be completed on the first sensor before the last sensor even hears the first shot.
So there's a lot of big data going on here. You have multiple variables coming in, and then you have to make sense of it. So there's some algorithm that processes all this in real time.
That's right. We do about 900,000 impulsive explosive sounds across the United States every year. They're all located and triangulated within about 2 or 3 seconds, depending on how long the sound itself lasts.
And how many feet? Within how many feet do you get? 10? 100?
The guaranteed accuracy of the system is 25 meters, which is about 80 feet.
Yeah.
But on average, it's better than 5 meters, which is about 15, 16 feet.
Wow.
The more
shots. So a car length or two?
Oh, it's usually good enough to tell you which side of the driveway. Wow. There are some cases where we're off by two buildings, and on average, we're right to a building or two. And that changes the dynamic for responding police, because even in the 13% of cases where somebody does call 911, 87% of the time, nobody calls 911.
Right.
But in the 13%, on average, they're somewhere between a quarter of a mile and a half a mile away. So if you pick up the phone and call the police and say, I'm a quarter or a half a mile away, actually, you don't say that part. All you say is, I live at 123 Main Street.
Yeah.
And I heard something.
Right.
The net result of that is that the police, they know you probably didn't do it.
Yeah.
And so they can drive near your house and then begin driving in circles, which is a tremendous waste of resources.
Unbelievable. Yeah. And then maybe they get two or three people and then they can start going from there. So how many deployments do you guys have?
85 cities in the U.S., San Francisco here. In fact, we're in a coverage area right now.
Mm-hmm.
Oakland, East Palo Alto, Richmond, San Pablo, and Redwood City here in the Bay Area. But we're in Chicago, Washington, D.C., Boston, New York City. Soon, it's just been announced that it'll be done by the end of the year.
New York City.
New York City, my hometown.
Really? Mine too. And all five boroughs will be, or just a couple of boroughs, or what?
I wish I could tell you.
Oh, okay.
It will be deployed widely.
It will be deployed widely. So in a place with skyscrapers like Manhattan and an extreme amount of density, how many sensors do you need to put up?
The average city has somewhere between 16 and 20 sensors per square mile.
16 to 20 per square mile. So in a 7x7 area, it'd be 50 square miles.
50 square miles, you'd have about 800 sensors thereabouts.
And I'm looking at a sensor right here. What is this sensor? This is not the outdoor one. This is the indoor one?
This is our newest technology. In the wake of the Sandy Hook shootings, but also the many other active shooter scenarios that we've seen, we've discovered two things that motivated the development of that indoor sensor. So that sensor can detect gunfire inside a room, doesn't locate it. It just says there was a gunshot near this sensor at this time.
Right.
There are two critical motivating facts. The first is that even though there are people in the building with an active shooter, the average call to 911 in an active shooter scenario takes place 5 or 6 minutes after the first shot is fired.
Ah.
Here's why. Schools are actually intentionally built to block sound because kids are loud.
Yeah.
And we don't want the sound to move around the building. Secondly, it is so completely unexpected that you would ever hear gunfire, thank God, in schools or buildings or government buildings, that people don't think that what they first hear is gunfire. They stick their head out.
Assume it's like a car backfiring.
That's exactly right. So the first problem is that people take a long time to call 911. And then, of course, when they do call 911, they get 911 is swamped with 10, 15 calls, all of which giving conflicting information.
And most of these school shootings are how many minutes long?
Active shooters in general, which is a bigger category than school shootings, two critical facts that motivated the development of this technology. One is that every 15 seconds on average, a life is lost during an active shooter scenario.
Wow. What is the definition of active shooter? It just means somebody who's going to shoots a lot of people?
It's a term that's been developed to describe somebody who goes into a specific place with the intent of shooting multiple people.
Got it. Okay. So it's a mass shooting person.
It's a mass shooting person.
Yeah.
Some of them are random. Some of them are targeted.
Right. Of course.
Military bases have them, unfortunately.
And almost universally on the statistics, the last 15 at least, were I think 13 out of the last 15 or 14 of the last 15 all had mental issues, which was incredible when you think about it. Like,
I think virtually by definition, to go into a building and shoot people, you must have a mental...
Right. Okay. So let me restate that.
Problem.
A diagnosed known medical condition. That was the crazy thing about it. Like almost in every case, the person was known to be disturbed.
So that's a statistic I hadn't seen. I have seen is that the responding officers have dramatically changed their policies. Back in Columbine, the mechanism was cordon off the building and let and wait until you've got enough force to go in. That has changed dramatically since then because we actually lost a lot of kids at Columbine to the delay before they entered the building.
Right.
Now the doctrine is—
Because they're assuming it's a hostage situation. It's never a hostage situation.
Before Columbine, the assumption was it was a hostage situation. Now it's get in the building and try to interdict. And the big problem is you don't know where the shooter is, which slows you down and also puts other people at risk.
So now you think that this will be in every classroom and then every school— or every hospital or every army base will have an alert go off to dispatch, like my ADT security system does, like a panic alarm. Shot was fired here. Cops are deployed. No discussion.
Our goal is to shorten the cycle to get to 911 and give them exactly what room they need to go to and watch the path through the building so that if the shooting starts in room one
and goes
down the hall,
they
know where to go.
So in order to do this, you critically have to have a architectural drawing of the building that can get to the police command center and to the people on duty. Is that infrastructure in place?
Well, that's where we really have secret sauce. So we've spent years, over a decade and a half, developing software that gives police situational awareness about where a gunshot took place relative to a building.
Mm-hmm.
Getting overlaid blueprints on top of the building is not complicated.
Mm-hmm.
Getting that information to officers was complicated 10 years ago, but now we can get it to a smartphone, we can get it to email.
Got it.
We can get an image in their hands that says red dot, it doesn't say, it shows a red dot and a room or a red dot in a building, and that's just about all they need.
So a police officer responding to a school like Sandy Hook, do those officers, how do the officers, they have in-car computers, but what do they have on their person going in? Are people saying, we're going to give an iPhone or an Android phone to officers to have, will they have a smart device on them?
officers' technology depends a lot on the department.
Of course.
San Francisco, I believe, has Android phones in the hands of most, if not all, officers. It certainly is the case that if officers do not have a department-issued phone, they've got their own.
There's so you can program your system to say, you know, Officer Calacanis has, this is Officer Calacanis's phone. We're just going to text him an image of the building.
Well, that's precisely what the technology does. It sends a message to whatever phones are registered, and that's all managed by the department. But right. it can be the personal phone of whatever whoever the officer is.
Got it. If an alert went off at a school, do you think what is the best practice to take the alert and then immediately go to the local, let's say it was Sandy Hook, go to Sandy Hook's police department, tell them a shot has gone fired to dispatch, or since it is a gun being fired, why doesn't it just go directly to dispatch and or every officer on duty or off duty? Because if you got every officer on and off duty to know there was a shot fired at a school, you might be able to get somebody there in half the amount of time. Just on the nature of who's on duty and not having that delay you talked about of people calling of 6 minutes. And you might have an off-duty officer who happens to be dropping their kids off from school. If you were running the department, because I know you're going to keep deferring to the departments. I'm sorry to cut you off, but what would you suggest they do? How would you design it for the department?
Wide distribution of information is the whole key in active shooter instances. There are regular exercises run across the country now to deal with active shooters. Half the departments we're in confront this as a policy decision all the time. Mm. Whether their department has everybody find out about active shooters or only active on-duty officers or just the SWAT team is going to depend on the size of the department. You don't want all 36,000 police officers in New York City to find out about every single instance of anything going on. You'd rapidly swamp the airwaves. On the other hand, if you have a department of 50 people, you might want to notify all 50.
Or in Manhattan, you might want to geofence and say every officer's going to run in the background on their smartphone a location app that will not be able to be accessed by anybody, but that if an alert goes out, it says, hey, listen, on 57th Street, a shot was fired. And if I happen to be a Brooklyn cop from Flatbush who is, you know, going to Woolman Rink in the park at Christmas time, and I happen to be parked on 58th Street, I can come around the corner.
So that technology is being deployed in all sorts of places nationwide already.
Really?
The geographically aware applications that give, it's not just first responders, it's not just police officers, it's all first responders. So you've got EMS personnel who mm-hmm. get notified quickly. You even have volunteer coordinators who get notified of things nearby. The location.
You could get people with carry permits. I know this is not politically correct here in San Francisco, but in other jurisdictions, Montana, Florida, whatever, Texas, the local cops are more than happy to give citizens carry permits, and in some places you can carry them. So a citizen who said, hey, I would like to be notified of a shooting so I can pretend I'm a cop.
I wouldn't be halfway surprised if that
happens.
Model is already happening.
You think that's happening? Wow.
I wouldn't be halfway surprised. I don't know of it, but I wouldn't be surprised.
It's really fascinating, too, because this is where the real huge gap between gun control is going to hit the sort of the fan, because there's going to be a large argument that if there's a school shooting and I'm a parent and I'm there's 20 parents within a mile or two of the school who have carry permits, which a lot of them do in a lot of places, and you're a parent, you kind of have the right to respond if this gun's going off at your school.
You know, one thing we know from the data is that the guns that are fired 95-99% of the time are being fired in an illegal manner. So it is not as if the gun crime in this country is being performed according to the rules. By the facts, you're shooting a gun illegally outdoors in an urban area everywhere we're deployed.
Hmm.
We see patterns that make arguments about legal weapons a lot less pertinent than arguments about the illegal use of weapons that would otherwise be legal. So for example,
yeah, please.
We see one round or two round shootings taking place on high school football fields throughout California, throughout actually the whole country, at 9:30 or 10 p.m. at night.
Now, so if this somebody happened, went to the football field and fired their gun into the dirt?
Somebody goes to a football field and a gun gets fired, one or two rounds, at 9:30 or 10 o'clock at night. Now, if this happened during the day, this would be an active shooter scenario.
Sure.
It would be a SWAT response.
Well, what is it at night? People are just shooting beer cans off of a fence?
Well, if it's an illegal weapon, you can't take it to a range, so you can't test it when you sell it illegally to the next guy.
Right.
And so there is actually a pattern
of
one or two round firings at in big backyards, open spaces, and school playgrounds because they're big open spaces. And then the gun goes down the street, and 3 hours later, the 10-round shooting takes place when one drug dealer is protecting his turf from another.
Wow.
That actual transaction can be tracked. Now, we can't tell you it's the same gun, but we see the pattern all the time. And so if the police can interdict it at the one or two shot stage, then that gun doesn't get used to kill somebody.
That's mind-blowing. So I would also think if you were going to do some crime of retribution or whatever, where you're going to go hit up a bank or a liquor store, you may want to test your firearm. Forget about even buying or selling it. Like if I know I'm going to go down the block and I'm going to shoot up this house because there's a rival drug gang or something, I might want to go check to make sure the gun's not jammed.
This is something we learned from the ATF, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and Explosives, that they can track the financial transaction behind a weapon. And one of the things that they're now getting from our data is they can punctuate it by the sound of the weapon being tested as it's sold. Nobody buys a weapon at face price without figuring out whether the weapon works. And one of the places you therefore see gun transactions taking place is large, empty, open spaces at night.
Fascinating. So if you were to have a gun problem, putting cameras in those locations, you're probably going to catch a couple of criminals. And now that you have the firing data, which you never had before, you can actually go and know which tape to pull.
You can do two things. You can spot the individuals who are shooting the guns. You can then pick up you can identify and then pick up the shell casings and using other technologies.
Oh, wow. I didn't even think of that. And you might find the actual fingerprints on the shell. Is this stuff court admissible? Has it come up in a court case yet?
It is court admissible. It's been admitted in criminal cases in 17 states. We just had a ruling at the Nebraska Supreme Court level establishing its scientific credibility. It has passed what's called the federal Dalbert standard. We can prove several things in court. A, that a weapon was fired at a specific location at a specific time. B, we can prove the sequence of shots. And C, we can prove what's called the intershot spacing. So if you have, say, an officer-involved shooting, or simply two assailants trying to shoot each other, we can prove that whoever was standing in spot A fired before whoever was standing in shot in
spot B.
Let me try that again.
Yeah.
We can prove that whoever was standing in spot A.
The sequence of shooting,
you can
and
shoot.
If, it, like in this case in Ferguson, we now know X number of shots, pause, four more shots. What are the four shots for after the first six? I mean...
So what we still don't know is whether the audio that we were presented is the real thing.
Okay, so let's assume the audio is for a second, for argument's sake. Why is that? What is the pause? Is the pause that the person, you know, tried to stand up after they've been shot six times? It's possible, I guess. I don't know. It's going to be some explaining to do.
We don't know, and we actually specialize in stopping our analysis right at the point where the science runs out. There is a case in Los Angeles that really tells this story well. There were two guys who were shot at by two assailants they actually knew.
Okay.
One of the assailants had a pistol, and pistols don't kick out shell casings. They stay inside.
Sure, they do.
I'm sorry, I said pistol. I meant revolver.
Revolver.
So a revolver keeps the shell casings, and a semi-automatic pistol kicks the shell casings out. So at the scene of the crime, there was only one set of shell casings. But both victims, one died. The second one reported that he was shot at by both assailants.
Hmm.
Due to the nature of the case, each assailant had a separate defending lawyer pointing the finger at the other assailant.
Right.
And so what we were able to prove listening to the acoustics was that there were two weapons fired, that they were fired at the same time, and that in three different cases, shots were fired in less than 1/10 of a second apart at a distance of 16 feet. Now, your arms are not that long. And you can't run back and forth 16 feet back and forth.
Impossible.
In a 10th of a second.
Right.
So that means that both people had to be firing and there had to be a weapon in both locations that were reported.
Right. So it just speeds up the justice process. Let me ask you a stupid question, I think, which is, would a balloon, like people are using drones and now weather balloons, that had sound recording on it, make this even more accurate? Or with cameras. So We've seen like drones now are coming to the police. And obviously, there's two types, quadcopters and regular flying like airplane drones. Putting those aside, the weather balloons seem to be an incredible possibility of people just putting up, you know, whatever, 150 feet in the air, a weather balloon with a, that could stay up for weeks or months. Have you guys thought about that with sound and then being able to get another sort of vantage point?
Commonly, our sensors are up on building rooftops, and those are 10 to 20 stories in the air. If the
so you've already got that, essentially.
We do already have the altitude. However, the ability to point the camera off of the drone has actually changed the way a number of different response patterns are taking place. This is moving across the world from the United States to South Africa. We have about 4,000 black rhinoceros left on the planet. Uh-huh. They are dying at a rate. They started being poached about 5 years ago at a rate of 100 or so a year. Last year, they lost over 1,000 rhinoceros, so three or four a day. Hmm. That means we have about 2.5-3 years to stop this or they're gone.
Wow.
We have actually not only caught poachers in South Africa, in Kruger National Park, illegally killing rhinoceros using our stuff, using ShotSpotter, but we're also now passing that data to drones that are flying over Kruger National Park. And here's the problem. Kruger is 20,000 square kilometers, and it's got 10, 20 rangers to patrol the entire thing.
Does it change? The drones don't automatically change course. Somebody's got to change the course. But
it depends on the drone. So the drones that we're feeding actually fly to the location and circle.
Are these quadcopters or drones? They're drones.
It depends on the configuration. There are two different types. One is a quadcopter, and that one hovers. The other one flies over, and then the whole point is to stay above the poachers because they're in the middle of, in this case,
would they
the
even
bush.
Know, I wonder? Would the poachers know that it's up there? What if they hear it?
I doubt that the poachers would know that it's there. Right. These are IR-equipped standoff surveillance devices. The whole key is to keep them in camera because it might take an hour to get out into the middle of the bush to get them.
And you might have evidence now, and you might have a pattern, and you might be able to follow them. And then eventually we'll have bombs we can drop them.
There was an 8% success rate of interdicting rhino poachers in February of this year. They had 12 killed. They got one set of poachers, two individuals. In the cases that we've been involved in, they have arrested four individuals. They've got a fifth one on trial now or about to be on trial. They've had 100% success rate getting to the poachers because normally the poachers take 12 hours to walk out of the park. That's how long it takes to get out there. And during those 12 hours, there's an awful long opportunity to stop them, find
Huge.
The evidence that they did.
Was that pro bono work for you guys? Are you getting paid?
It is pro bono to date.
That's kind of nice.
There's a financial model associated with its being successful, but to us, the key is to maintain the species.
So what does it cost to put this kind of thing into a city, and then who pays?
There's been a lot of business innovation at ShotSpotter in the last 5 years to change the answer to the question you've just asked.
Good. So where'd you start and where are you now?
We used to sell this as capital equipment that the city owned, and it was on the order of $250,000 per square mile. That was expensive equipment. Cities don't like to buy IT equipment in the first place or cameras in the first place.
Yeah, it's a disaster.
And so as we got to scale, we did three things that dramatically changed our posture. First of all, we own the equipment now. It's on our balance sheet. And so we're watching the more than 5,000 sensors that are deployed nationwide on an hourly basis at a scale that nobody else is capable of doing in an individual city.
Right. So you don't have to train any IT people.
We don't have to provide IT resources with training. We don't have to scale up the program management at the department.
Right.
And then the second piece of the equation is we drop the price dramatically. Because we own the equipment and we can negotiate for cellular data rates on machine-to-machine basis for cloud infrastructure, the price is now a little around $50,000 per square mile per year.
Amazing.
So it's 20% of as expensive as it used to be.
It's too cheap.
What it actually has resulted in is much bigger coverage areas. So San Francisco started as a 3-square-mile coverage area. It will be 13 square miles by the end of this year, 12.5 square miles by the end of this year. Oakland started at 6. It will be 13.5 and is about to expand again. The average coverage area size has gone from the 1 square mile we were in Redwood City all the way up to about 5, and we have, I think,
so, wait,
five,
you're saying
we have
50,
at least 5 that are now 15
year,
square miles.
$50,000 per year per mile?
$50,000 per square mile per year.
Right. So if we have a 10-mile place, it's going to be $500,000. And so to put that in context, officers cost each department probably in the magnitude of $250,000 a year with all their equipment and everything.
In California, they're about that expensive.
Yeah. So
The average deployment being five
like
square miles, it's 1 to 1.5
cops.
Full-time equivalents. And it's important to point out that the funding that goes to cops is not the same funding that goes to operational
technology
expenses.
Right. This is not going to reduce the number of cops on the street. It's going to make them more effective and let them do other things.
That's what all of the departments that have been successful have proven. That's actually what East Palo Alto ended up doing. They ended up allowing officers to go to the same households that are the recipient of gunfire 4 times in a month and say, okay, look, what's going on here?
Yeah.
Why did you get shot up?
10 years, where are you going to be with this? I mean, what's the world going to look like in 10 years if you guys succeed?
In 10 years, there's not going to be a major city in the world where if you fire a gun, the police don't know about it within a few seconds. They will know where you are, they will show up, and they will stop you from doing that.
It's amazing. It's a great vision. It's really important work. And, you know, I think as a society, if we can't agree on weapon ownership, at least we can agree that the statistics show, like you're saying, 90-95% of the usage is illegal, and we all want that stopped. I don't know one – I'm a gun owner. I know a lot of gun owners. I don't know one gun owner who doesn't want to see criminals have their guns taken away. Because it makes the rest of us look terrible, who are good gun owners, who are trained and who use it responsibly.
As a company, we don't take a posture, but we've got as many gun owners as non-gun owners in the business.
Yeah.
And
about you personally?
I'm a gun owner.
You're a gun owner. And so for you, you believe gun ownership is a right and it's fine, but you are more than willing to live in a world where if you fire your gun, everybody knows.
There's no reason that guns should be fired in places where it's illegal to fire guns.
Right.
Nobody
so I'm saying
who has one believes that that is the
right.
Let me rephrase that. Nobody who has one and is responsible thinks that's reasonable.
Let me ask you a question on a personal basis. Would you be okay with your gun's location being tracked 100% of the time? The GPS location of the gun being in a central database that could be pulled? Or the firing, and that's two different questions there, obviously. So would you, your firing data is captured or your location of the gun is captured? What do you think of that? Because I haven't really thought about it myself as a gun owner.
That's an incredibly complex question.
Yeah.
Because the reason that the Second Amendment exists is, of course—
Tyranny.
As a mechanism to avoid tyranny and to create the balance of power that a militia brings. By definition, if the militia is disenfranchised by its own inability to be effective as a fighting force, then this doesn't work.
Right.
So I don't have a good answer. I would say that my personal gun use is not that of a militiaman. And so therefore, my answer is not.
And you don't own it for tyranny reasons either, I bet. Like you didn't buy your gun because you're like, my God, we may have to overthrow the government at some point.
That's correct.
Neither did I. I'm just worried about a dude hopping the fence. That's all. I'm just worried about a guy jumping the fence.
Or in my case, I didn't feel that I could be working with police officers and not know what firing a gun was like.
Yeah, that's a good point too. All right, listen, this has been amazing. I think you have an amazing company. Is the company successful right now? Because it seems like a very hard thing to do, to sell into all these departments something like this, and it takes so long. Is the company successful? Is it going to make it? Is it going to do well?
Oh, yes. Motorola Solutions is our big strategic investor. They're about $75 million invested in the business. It's successful, growing.
Oh, so Motorola owns a big piece of the business.
They do. Motorola Solutions.
Solutions.
Not the Google one.
Not the Google one. Motorola Solutions is a separate company.
That's right. They provide everything
from radios
to dispatch systems.
So they're stoked because this is something they could sell in as an add-on to the police departments.
Motorola's whole business is around creating what's called real-time communications, either radio or technology systems that give you a common operating picture. Real-time crime centers driven by real-time crime information are the next step for them and for us. And so we have the only available real-time information about gunfire, which is one of the highest pain point real-time crimes that any crime center needs to know about.
What would this cost to do, like, per classroom? Is it going to cost like $10 a month per classroom, $100 a month per classroom, $1,000 a year per classroom? What
do you think? Unlike the government business, the private sector business for that sort of equipment, and even for the regulated monopoly side, which is private sector, but it's regulated monopoly. Actually, we need to be able to provide a capital equipment structure as well as a service business. So we have two models. You can either buy the data as a service from us for your building, or you can buy the equipment. Most of the utility companies actually want to buy equipment because they can then turn that around as what's called a an increase in their rate base capital investment that they are making that the regulators will let them pass along to consumers.
Got it. Interesting. Because I think, you know, like this is something where I think we should just federally mandate that in every school, every classroom has one of these ShotSpotters, and that it's paid for forever, and that we know when a gun goes off in a school.
Or nothing more. In a government building or a military base or any of the places where...
Yeah, I'm going to start with schools because like who's going to argue against kids being safe? And if it costs... whatever, 10, 20 grand a year to do a school, like we have to figure out a way as a society to make sure that you can do this because it is critical. These school shootings are, I mean, I know they don't happen that often, but the cost is just ungodly for a child to lose their life. And we have technology that could cut the, you know, an active shooter's time in half or the death count in half. Like this would be amazing. And then if people know this technology exists, they're going to behave differently, I think, right? Are you affecting behavior in Oakland or in those places? They know that their gun's going to get... taken from them because they know that the gun firing results in cops immediately?
Oh, there's no question that in our urban deployments, which we now have years of experience with, there is a cause and effect relationship between police going from not showing up at the right spot because they don't know about it 80%, 85%
No, but do bad guys know that this is deployed?
As soon as the word gets out that the police start showing up, then the behavior changes. Whether they know that it's because the police suddenly found out or because it's of us, or they know that it's our doing is another story. We do have there are some cases where we know for a fact that the word is out on the street that if you fire a gun, they're going to be on you because of ShotSpotter.
Yeah.
By and large, our objective is to get the police to the right spot.
Yeah.
That message in and of itself,
they got to
the crime rate.
I think they got to let people know because when criminals found out that cops were wearing cameras. Their behavior changed. Just like the cop behavior got better, the criminal behavior got better. The people stopped resisting arrest because they knew they were on camera.
That's the dashboard camera effect, which is now the worn camera effect.
Which I think is the ShotSpotter effect. If people know in a city that firing a gun results in cops on the way, they're going to change their behavior two ways. One, they're going to fire and run, but they're also going to fire if they're not going to fire. Because I'm like, this is not worth it. Why am I going to, you know, shoot? If they do that, like sort of shooting unnecessarily at a football field kind of thing.
Most cities that deploy see that exactly that reduction because it is fairly well advertised in San Francisco. It's advertised in Oakland. Yeah. It's advertised even in East Palo Alto.
All right, James. Listen, congratulations on building an important company and all the great success. I can't wait till this thing is deployed everywhere. ShotSpotter.com if you want to learn more. And you can follow the show at TWI Startups and you can follow me at Jason. Thanks to our friends at WeWork. Emily is just killing it on operations. All the events are going so well. Launch Scale coming up in October and Launch Festival the first week in March. You can find all that information at launch.co, launch.co. Thanks to my Emmy Award-winning producer, Jackie. And Jacob and I, we're going to get that fifth Emmy for you, and we're all going to have Emmys on our desk. That's the big plan here. All right, listen, we'll see you next time on This Week in Startups. Bye-bye.